Hi, everybody. This is Dr. A with your clinical chemistry considerations for the geriatric patient video, and we're going to dive into this. So let's first look at the impact of geriatric patients on healthcare. So in 2010, there will be over 40 million individuals in the U.S. that are age 65 years and older, which that made up about 13% of the population in 2010. The baby boomers began to turn 65 in 2011, which increased the number of people over the age of 65 to nearly 50 million. So that is a 10 million jump in just 5 years. And so that's 50 million sorry, in 2015. Life expectancy has increased significantly. In 2010, the average female was expected to live to 80.8 years and the average male to 75.7 years. The total population over the age of 65 is expected to reach 88.5 million in the U.S. by 2050, which is more than doubling the 2010 numbers and making up over 20% of the total population. So they have a big impact on healthcare. Of course, part of the concern here is that it is at age 65 and older that we have the most consumption of healthcare. And so the cost in healthcare and having enough resources and services available is a very big concern. Geriatrics is the branch of healthcare that's concerned with the care of the aged, and gerontology is the study of aging. So some of the considerations for our elderly is that they have a diminished physiologic reserve, so it's harder for them to bounce back and to recover from illnesses. They have age-dependent changes in concentration of analytes, which are important in a number of areas of chemistry. There are also several examples of chemistry values that are unchanged as a consequence of age. Some of the general physiological changes that are associated with aging. So in muscle, there is a decrease in lean body mass and a decrease in total creatinine production, such that serum creatinine is no longer a reliable measure or assessment of renal function. And if you think about it, it's kind of simple. So they elderly lose muscle mass that causes a creatinine level to drop, but then their renal function declines, which then would cause a creatinine level to increase. And so the decrease and the increase kind of cancel each other out, and they end up with very similar creatinine results as when they were healthier adults. But they've lost muscle mass and lost renal function, and the creatinine doesn't really picture that accurately. In bone, the serum calcitonin levels typically rise with age, but the ionized calcium levels remain stable. Ionized calcium is the biologically active calcium that is not bound to protein, and it's about half of total calcium levels. In the GI system, there will be an increase in vitamin B12 deficiency from poor absorption. There's also poor absorption of other vitamins and nutrients just because of aging of the GI system. In the kidney and urinary system, aging will cause a decline in glomerular filtration rate as kidney function declines. In the immune system, the thymus shrinks with age. So the thymus is the biggest as a baby, and then it helps to build the immune system and is very active during the younger years, childhood, etc. But as we become adults, it shrinks, and the older we are, the smaller the thymus is. So then that causes a decrease in the thymosin levels and a decrease in T cell function, which then is a decrease in immune system response. In the endocrine system, adrenocorticotropic hormone and cortisol levels typically do not change with age, but the stress response may be delayed. So those were your stress hormones. So they're still produced adequately. Like I said, the whole recovery when one is ill, it just takes longer when a person is older. Sex hormones, there is an expected reduction in the gonadal production of estrogen and progesterone in women and testosterone in men, and with a secondary increase in the hypothalamic gonadotropin-releasing hormone. So that gonadotropin-releasing hormone is what signals the gonads to release estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, and because the gonads aren't functioning due to age, or they're not functioning as well due to age, all of those levels will then decline. And glucose metabolism, usually insulin secretion is unchanged, but you can see age-related changes at the cellular level in insulin signaling, usually going towards insulin resistance, where there's not a good response to the binding of insulin. There's receptor changes, glucose transporter changes and stuff, so that when a person becomes older and passes the age of 65, the risk of developing things like type 2 diabetes increase also. So let's look at the effect of age on the values of lab tests. So factors that laboratorians should consider when interpreting tests for the elderly. First is exercise. Are they exercising? Have they recently exercised? How long do they exercise? What type of exercise do they do? Are they on any kind of medications? The average elderly person is on what we call polypharmacy, meaning on multiple prescription drugs at the same time. Those can cause interferences with certain lab tests. Mobility, immobility, and posture can affect lab results. So is this person bedbound? Are they wheelchair bound? Are they sitting? Are they laying down when you're collecting the sample and stuff? And every day. So these things can affect certain lab tests. What's the nutritional status? Are they eating adequately? A lot of times elderly people don't eat as much, and they don't feel like cooking. They don't feel like fussing with it. Sometimes they may even forget to eat. So what's that, you know, and how is that affecting their lab results? What are their personal habits? Are they involved in drinking alcohol or smoking? And do they have any chronic or subchronic disorders? So, you know, a typical chronic disorder could be like COPD or, you know, congestive heart failure or something like that. A subchronic disorder may be something that goes undetected, so it's been chronic for a while, but it's not being picked up, or it's just kind of there in the background and might potentially be missed. Then here's a good one. What's the validity of the reference intervals? And should there be age-specific reference intervals? So currently, your average, your lab reference intervals are going to be based on healthy adults that are of the age of between 18 and 50 years. And the question is arising now, especially if we look in forward to 2050, where 20% of the population is going to be over the age of 65. Should we establish age-specific reference ranges for older adults? Currently, there aren't really any that have been established, but it would require some studies, population studies, and to set those appropriately. And then there are specimen collection variables, site trauma, and volume. So, you know, the collection site on elderly, sometimes there's less availability. It may be harder to get to certain sites. Their veins are more fragile, so you can get trauma. The veins can blow, it can be bruising, etc. It's often harder to get an adequate volume of sample. So, yeah, those are all things to consider. So let's look specifically at different body systems with the normal age-related range changes and then the lab values that correlate. So in the musculature system, there's a decrease in muscle mass, which then translates into a decrease in creatinine, which is often then compensated by an increase in creatinine from the decrease in kidney function, renal function. So if early on the creatinine levels can drop as they lose muscle mass, but then as renal function declines, creatinine levels go back up. Bone, there is a decreased mineral content of bone, so there is increased risk of osteoporosis and fractures, etc. And there's a decreased amount of cartilage, meaning a lot of elderly people end up with knee replacements, hip replacement and stuff because their joints are lacking cartilage and it's painful to move. The lab values that correlate to that are going to be an increase in parathyroid hormone, especially in females, and just could be linked also to vitamin D deficiency. There will be decrease in calcium and calcitonin. Again, the decrease in calcium can be tied to vitamin D deficiency. In the GI system, there's going to be a decrease in gastric motility, which also is going to show decrease in vitamin absorption and decrease in drug absorption as the GI system ages, which then translates to decreased vitamin B12 levels, decreased calcium levels, decreased iron absorption and iron levels. And then that in hematology could translate to an iron deficiency anemia here with the low iron levels. In the kidneys, there's a decrease in renal function, which is going to be mirrored with an increase in serum atrial natriuretic peptide and brain natriuretic peptide, and an increase in erythropoietin, but a decrease in renin and glomerular filtration rate. So the increase in erythropoietin is to compensate for the anemia that develops. So it tries to signal to the bone marrow to make more red cells. But of course, if there's not enough iron, it's going to be a problem. So they tend to just always have slightly elevated erythropoietin levels. In the immune system, there's a decrease in hematopoietic stem cell activities, a decrease in bone marrow activity, which again ties back into the anemia with the high erythropoietin and the low iron. There's also a decrease in thymosins because of the thymus shrinking and a decrease in T cell function, so it's harder to fight off infections. There's an increase in autoimmune antibodies, which then would be translated by high or an increased levels of positive ANAs and positive other for the other autoimmune disease antibodies. In the endocrine system, there's an increase in cancer incidences of the endocrine system with a decrease in aldosterone and a decrease in norepinephrine. And in the reproductive system, the sex hormones are decreased, so obviously then you see decreased testosterone, estrogen, progesterone, DHEAS, and pregnenolone levels, and an increase in gonadotropin-releasing hormone, trying to compensate for that decrease in those sex hormones. Some preanalytical variables to consider with the elderly and chemistry results. So again, we've mentioned these already, but diet, gender, posture, whether they're sitting or bedbound, smoking, alcohol consumption, body composition as in muscle mass, fat mass, physical activity, prescribed medications, all of those can affect clinical chemistry results. And there's just a variety of analytes that can be affected in that, again, have to look at that per analyte. There are also the physical and the physiologic changes of aging that can affect the collection and the quality of a specimen. So phlebotomy can be a challenge in the geriatric patients. For example, some of the factors that affect specimen collection are arthritis. So if the patient has joint pain and joint ache, it may be hard for them, for example, simply to extend their arm out fully so that you can get a good access to an antecubital vein. So, and you may have to stick the back of the hand, and that could cause trauma. They can cause the veins to blow, etc. They can also, they're subject to malnutrition and dehydration, which then lowers the blood volume and makes it harder to collect blood. Decrease in muscle tone, skin elasticity, there's vein issues. So because of all that put together, their veins can roll around their arms really bad. It's going to be sometimes like trying to chase it with a needle. It's kind of hard to get good phlebotomy on geriatric patients. Diseases that are prevalent in the elderly are hypertension or high blood pressure, arthritis or joint inflammation, heart disease, cancers, diabetes, but type 2 diabetes especially, asthma, and chronic bronchitis emphysema, so the COPDs, and stroke. So there are also age-associated changes in drug metabolism. So overdosing and adverse drug reactions are a problem in the elderly. So the adverse drug reactions are often due to polypharmacy and also a decline in liver and renal function. And then overdosing has to do with memory problems, and so they may not, it's not usually not intentional. They forgot that they've taken their morning dose and then they take it again, or they forget which day of the week it is, and so they're all prone to overdoses. They're also, and even if they take it on time and get the appropriate dosage, there are changes in absorption distribution and metabolism and excretion of drugs that are affected by the aging process. For example, there's a prolonged gastric emptying time, so that causes a delay in drug absorption. So if the drug is supposed to be absorbed in, you know, normally in an hour or something like that for an orally administered drug, maybe it'll take them longer, 2 hours or something like that. There's an impaired absorption of injected drugs due to decreased blood flow. And then the elimination of drugs through the kidneys is decreased because renal function is declined. And the psychosocial factors, elderly are more prone to depression, dementia, poverty, and loneliness. And there are several geriatric syndromes that are typical, such as difficulty swallowing, and again, malnutrition, just not interested in eating, sleep problems, bladder control problems, which can also tie to sleep problems, delirium and dementia, especially after sundown. People that have problems with dementia, it tends to get worse at night. Vision problems, hearing problems, dizziness, fainting, difficulty walking, falls, osteoporosis, and pressure ulcers. Just all things that are very common in to our geriatric patients. And the effects of exercise and nutrition on the elderly and chemistry results. So the benefits of exercise for the elderly, and this is part of the Silver Sneakers programs, is it improves overall health and cerebral function. It increases social contact. So then they have a little walking group, a little exercise group, a water aerobics group, and that, you know, can lower depression too. It reduces cardiovascular risk, helps control weight, increases the functional capacity, and improves nutrients intake and sleep. The effects of exercise on test results should be considered, they are also at an increased risk for poor nutritional status. So nutritional assessment can be done, can help prevent and identify different nutritional deficiencies in the elderly, and then that can help prevent some of the chronic diseases of aging, because a lot of those have a nutritional component. The most widely used test of that is the prealbumin, also known as the transthyretin test, because it would change first to assess nutritional status and to see if they're actually eating enough and taking in enough proteins. So as a recap, these are the clinical chemistry results that are expected to be increased. So we have alkaline phosphatase, GGT, C-reactive protein, erythropoietin, ferritin, transferrin, fibrinogen, folic acid, follicle-stimulating hormone, free T4, thyroid-stimulating hormone, thyroid-binding globulin, gamma globulins, homocysteine, insulin, lactate, parathyroid hormone, calcitonin, potassium, and triglycerides. So those are all expected to be increased in the elderly. Those that are expected to be decreased are ADH, or antidiuretic hormone, aldosterone, DHEAS, testosterone, estrogen, progesterone, growth hormone, IGF-1, T3, total protein, albumin, vitamin B12, ferritin, LDL cholesterol, total cholesterol, PO2, uric acid, and vitamin D. And the ones that are unchanged are going to be ACTH, cortisol, calcium, sodium chloride, creatinine, HDL, insulin, total T4, and pH. And I do note that we have ferritin in both decreased and increased. And I would say it is more likely for it to be decreased because serum iron is more likely to be decreased. Also, so then the storage form of iron be decreased because they are at a higher risk of iron deficiency anemia. That's also tied to their nutritional status. But in men with certain liver conditions, so and hematochromatosis, then over a lifetime they may have increased ferritin levels, and that would affect liver function. So there are both possibilities are there. So. There we go. And then the unchanged, ACTH, cortisol, calcium, sodium chloride, creatinine, HDL, insulin, total T4, and pH. So that is a recap of everything. And this is the last slide. So I thank you for your attention, and you guys have a blessed day.